Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. In order to get in as many members as possible, short and succinct questions and responses would be appreciated. Question number one has been withdrawn. At question number two, I call Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it is supporting childcare providers.
Minister Natalie Dawn Innes.
The Scottish Government is taking a range of actions to support a diverse, thriving and sustainable sector. Despite the financial challenges we're facing, the Scottish Government has prioritised funding to enable childcare workers in the private and third sector, delivering funded early learning and childcare, to be paid at least the real living wage from April 25. We are the only part of the UK to do so, and this was backed by £16 million of investment in 24-25. In parallel, we continue to work with the sector and local government to progress the longer-term reforms to the sustainable rate-setting process recommended by last year's joint Scottish Government and COSLA rates review. And we've also legislated to continue the nursery rates relief scheme, estimated to be worth around £11 million a year to childcare businesses.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm grateful for the Minister for that response. The data published alongside the Early Learning Childcare Expansion Interim Evaluation Report highlighted that between 2018 and 2022, there was a 19% decrease in the number of childcare providers in Scotland. In England, that reduction was just 10%. This would indicate a lack of adequate support for the sector and the providers. The Minister has previously stated that the Government are assured that the childcare sector is in fact economically sustainable. Can she confirm to us today that is still the case, and will the Government publish the evidence that supports that view?
Minister.
Well, I'm very confident in the economic model, and we continue to monitor the financial sustainability of the sector through our financial sustainability health checks. But I want to be clear, ensuring that sustainability is a priority for me. You know, I've been very clear, PVI are such an integral part of our childcare sector in Scotland. So in terms of further work, I think this fits in quite well with the rates review around both updating sustainable rates guidance, but as well as working with local government and funded providers to consider options for obtaining more robust and more reliable cost data to, you know, direct future approaches. So I'd be happy to meet with the member if he'd like to discuss the progress on this further, but I hope that sort of answers the question.
Brief supplementary, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you. Can the Minister please indicate what level of national uptake there has been on the SNP's initiative of giving 3 to 5 year olds up to 1,140 hours of funded early learning and childcare a year, following the support given to the childcare providers?
Minister.
So recent evidence shows that the estimated uptake rate remains very high, with over 92,000 children accessing funded ELC in 23. And this includes 97% of 3- and 4-year-olds, and 90% of those accessing the offer are using their full entitlement. Further to this, improvement service reporting shows that in September 23, 90% of 3- and 4-year-olds who were accessing funded ELC were using their full entitlement of 1140 hours a year. Now, I think Ms Dunbar will agree that this is extremely positive and directly contributing to this government's mission to tackle child poverty, given that every family who is utilising this universal offering is saving roughly £5,000 per year per child.
Megan Gallagher.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And with the brief conversation I had with the Minister beforehand, I thought it would be remiss of me if I wasn't able to come in with a brief supplementary. A constituent contacted me regarding the eligibility criteria, as their child was not able to start obtaining 1140 after they turned 3 years old. And this would suggest what Martin Whitfield was raising about the lack of support for private providers. So can the Minister advise what conversation she's having with local government in order to make sure that children can access 1140 when they turn 3 years old.
Minister.
I appreciate the question from Ms Gallagher, and I would want, you know, parents and families to be able to to receive their entitlement as soon as possible. I appreciate that different local authorities have different guidelines around this. I would you know, emphasise that it is for local authorities to set these guidelines, but of course, you know, I would encourage local authorities to ensure that they are not only speaking to parents and, you know, consulting with parents on their needs, but they are doing their best to ensure that children can receive that offer as quickly as possible once they are entitled to it.
Willie Rennie.
The Government's recent report that's already been referred to indicates there's been a significant shift from the private, voluntary and independent sector workforce to the council workforce. Does that not mean the Minister needs to act with more urgency to close the gap in funding that the former First Minister, Hamza Yousaf, promised that he would do?
Minister.
I mean, I believe since being in post, I have worked with urgency, and I've regularly and, you know, very passionately spoken about how valued our PVI sector is and how I want to do everything I can to ensure their financial sustainability. Again, I'll take back to the sustainable rates guidance, which I think has some really key measures in it in terms of setting rates, whether that's looking at the process for two-year-olds, whether that's looking at the meal rates and whether they are reflective of true costs, and also looking at how local authorities are supporting private settings for additional support needs children. So there are a range of actions underway that I think are going to make a real difference to the sector, and I have had positive feedback from the sector on.
Question number three, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government about recent discussions it has had with the UK Government regarding the provision of levelling up funding for areas of multiple deprivation, such as Drumchapel in my Glasgow Anne Island constituency.
Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes.
I raised this very issue with the Deputy Prime Minister when I met her last Friday, and that is on top of our regular contact with the UK Government on a range of issues, including the future of levelling up and other funds.
Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that response. People in my constituency feel betrayed. Westminster promised funding for projects and communities across Scotland, only for them to see these promises abandoned, firstly by the Tories and now at Labour's altar of austerity. I have today written to the Secretary of State for Scotland, urging him to deliver the funding promised to Scotland's Parliament to properly fulfil the promises made to communities like the one I represent in Drumchapel. Does the Minister agree with me that this funding cannot be a casualty of Labour austerity, and that rather than bypassing Scotland's Parliament and undermining devolution, any funding should be for this Parliament to deliver for the people of Scotland and their priorities?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the Member makes a very compelling case for why decisions should be made as close to those who are benefiting as possible, namely here in the Scottish Government. As I mentioned, I raised this with the Deputy Prime Minister last week. I reiterated the concerns that we have about the Levelling Up Fund and the way it has, under previous regimes, been overly politicised. The big risk, as I understand it, is the 30th of October and the UK Government's statement on the budget. We sincerely hope that decisions will not be made at that budget which impact Scotland and indeed the community in Drumchapel negatively.
Supplementary, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The manner in which the projects that were put forward by Glasgow was determined was extremely opaque and gatekept by Glasgow City Council. But notwithstanding that, will the Deputy First Minister confirm when the Scottish Government's own regeneration funds, such as the Vacant Derelict Land Fund and the Regeneration Capital Grant Fund, will be reopened because other projects are critically dependent on that funding?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Member understands just how essential the Scottish Government's regeneration funding has been. He will also understand that if I can't get any clarity from the UK Government right now on their own schemes, then it stands to reason that it's very difficult to give him any commitments right now in advance of the UK Government's budget or our Scottish Government budget. Our sincere hope, and I hope that he will use his offices to put pressure on his colleagues, is that there is a fair settlement in order to allow us to continue to support communities. And when it comes to the Levelling Up Fund, it is less opaque, less politicised and more impactful.
Question number four, Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of any impact on public services of an increased population in areas such as Midlothian.
Minister Cocab-Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our population strategy, published in 2021, includes a more balanced population component focused on a sustainable distributed population. A localised population growth has been discussed at the joint government, Scottish Government and COSLA population round table, which includes representatives from all local authorities. The Ministerial Population Task Force has also considered exploratory research about factors driving population growth, including its impact on public service planning and delivery. We're expected COSLA to bring forward an overview of local challenges stemming from population growth at a future roundtable meeting to help inform the work of the task force and further collaborative delivery of the population strategy.
Christine Graham. I thank the Minister for a very comprehensive answer. According to the most recent census in 2022, Midlothian's population has increased by 16% since 2011, five times higher than the Scottish average. And that will be an understatement given the current position with substantial housing developments month after month. So pressures on nurseries, schools, medical practices, let alone roads, is substantial, can only get worse. I hear what the Minister has to say and I'd ask her in her representations with COSLA and so on, to suggest that Midlothian is a special case given the really explosion of population in that area.
Minister.
I thank Christine Graham for putting her question in such a representative manner of her, the tensions that she faces in the areas that she represents. Each local authority does receive its fair share of total funding provided by the Scottish Government. This needs-based distribution methodology is kept under constant review and is agreed with COSLA on behalf of local authorities each year. Although the formula takes into account a range of factors, it is primarily based on population. It follows, therefore, that if the population of a council area grows faster than other local authority areas, they will receive an increased share of the available funding, all other factors being equal. The Scottish Government is always open to suggestions to improve the funding formula. However, the proposals must come through COSLA, as would be correct in the first instance.
Question number five, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met with senior representatives from the Scottish hospitality industry.
Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes.
Less than 2 hours ago is the straight answer, and I met with the Scottish Hospitality Group to discuss the challenges and opportunities that they face, and I want to use the opportunity to commend and endorse the work that Scottish hospitality as an industry does, often the linchpin of local economies. They are a major, important, vital employer, offering so many excellent, skilled career paths to all people across Scotland. It is indeed the pride of Scotland, offering high quality service and excellent food and drink.
I thank the Minister for that answer. I'm glad that my question was a prompt for her to meet the industry. As the recent Brand Scotland report from this Parliament's cross-party group on beer and pubs confirms, 2% of Scotland's pubs closed last year, compared to 0.9% in England, and the report makes a number of recommendations on how to stem these losses. In my own area, the Goblin Hall in Gifford, an iconic heritage pub, which forms almost half of the main street of the village, now lies shuttered and in darkness, having closed twice under two tenants in the last 12 months. The local community is rightly concerned about the impact, not just the loss of a local community gathering place, but also the loss of vital jobs and tourism revenues. Rural pubs are paying a heavy price for this government's failure to provide adequate support, particularly in relation to business rates. So will the Minister therefore agree to meet with me to discuss the findings of the CPG report and to explore how this government can provide a lifeline to struggling pubs like the Goblin Hall in Gifford?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member makes a very compelling case about the importance of hospitality businesses, not just in terms of the economic impact, but often as a centrepiece for local community activity. And the stats make that clear. Scottish hospitality comprises 14,815 businesses last year, accounting for 9% of all businesses in Scotland, contributing £4.7 billion in GVA and a major employer employing 216,000 people in 2022. That's 8% of all employment. So while the member hones in on the specifics of a local case, I can also take him back to the macro impact on why it's on all of us to support Scottish hospitality, to make sure it has a thriving future and to do everything within our power to save our high streets as well.
Question number six, Rhoda Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its long-term ferry strategy to ensure reliability for communities.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We published our updated vessel and ports plan earlier this year, and Transport Scotland published the consultation report and in its initial responses on the 3rd of September. This confirmed that reliability and resilience as the first priority of the plan. To support that, we are delivering 6 new major vessels for CalMac and procuring 7 new small vessels. The plan also confirms that we will retain a resilience vessel to cover planned and unplanned outages, and also to introduce two vessel summer services on the Little Minch, adding capacity and resilience to the Western Isles and the network as a whole.
Rhoda Grant.
It seems that a day doesn't go by without further delays to the new ferries and breakdowns to the existing fleet. South Uist again bears the brunt of the cancellations. Businesses again are being failed. And added to that, we're now in a period of annual maintenance to the fleet. I see that the Hebridean Isles, which is due to be scrapped next month, is to provide lifeline services to cover. I wonder if the Minister will now admit that there is a requirement for standby capacity to the fleet, and if it's possible to retain the Hebridean Isles in the fleet beyond November to do this, and will he provide compensation to businesses before they're forced off island due to ferry failures?
Minister.
I don't think, Presiding Officer, there's ever been any lack of consideration that a resilience vessel would be required. However, in reference to the boat that she's talking about, it's not possible to retain that one beyond this point because it would need a major overhaul, and both CMAL and CalMac have anticipated that there will be out for many months as a result of that overhaul, to then only be disposed of when the new vessels come into play early next year. But as I said, the plan that has been set out before is looking at the resilience across all sectors, and I'll be very happy to meet the member to discuss what that looks like as we go forward.
Question number 7, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recommendations in the recent Oxfam Scotland report, cleared for takeoff a private jet tax for Scotland.
Minister Ivan McKee.
The Scottish Government welcomes the contribution from Oxfam Scotland and will consider the taxation of private jets as part of our work to introduce air departure tax. We continue to explore all options to implement ADT in a way that protects lifeline services in the Highlands and Islands, and will work with the UK Government on how this can be achieved in compliance with its subsidy control regime. The UK-wide air passenger duty, including the higher rate, which already applies to private jets, will apply in Scotland until ADT is introduced.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that constructive answer? Oxfam have calculated that introducing a tax on private jets in Scotland could raise nearly £22 million a year, which is enough to deliver fairer fares on trains that commuters really need. And we heard last week from the First Minister FMQs that he would be very much in the spirit of embedding such a tax on luxury travel in a future air departure tax. So would the Cabinet Secretary similarly support this initiative? And can he provide more detail on the discussions that his government currently is undertaking with the UK government on the introduction of an air departure tax for Scotland, and in particular the intricacies around the details of an exemption for Highlands and Islands? How much progress can we actually see, Cabinet Secretary, in the months ahead on this?
Minister.
The Scottish Government continue to engage constructively with the new UK Government and will report back on progress on that in due course, but we are very keen, as I'm sure the new UK Government are, to make progress on this issue in compliance with state aid rules and ensuring that we continue to support Highland and Island connectivity. With regards to the specifics in the Oxfam report, I can say that I've asked officials to engage with Oxfam on the substance and the details around their calculations. Having had a quick look at the report myself, I would have to say that it doesn't appear at first glance to have taken into account behavioural impacts, which is interesting considering that the primary thrust of the report is to reduce travel by private jet in the interests of climate change. But I said I asked my officials to engage constructively to understand the basis of calculation, and of course we'll continue to engage with all parties across the chamber with regards to discussions in terms of what will be included in the forthcoming Scottish Government budget.
Concise question number 8, Brian Whittle.
Presiding Officer, as always, to ask the Scottish Government what steps it's taken to ensure school meals meet or exceed existing nutritional standards.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
We expect all local authorities to comply with the high standards set out in the Nutritional Requirements for Food and Drink in Schools Scotland Regulations 2020, which are accompanied by supporting statutory guidance. Education Scotland Health and Nutrition Inspectors monitor school food and drink provision as part of the school inspection programme.
Brian Whittle.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? I mean, school meals are a crucial way to offer a balanced nutritional meal, so important in tackling hunger, malnutrition, attainment, behavioural issues, physical and mental health. So can I ask this Cabinet Secretary if she believes the current nutritional standards are of a sufficiently high enough standard to meet these criteria?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm cognisant of time, Presiding Officer. There is a technical working group, however, which has independently advised on the development of nutritional standards. That group has had a primary focus on the health and well-being of children and young people. I'm more than happy to engage with the member on this directly, because I know it's an issue that he's raised in the chamber previously.